Our keynote topic for today is making metros more sustainable. Following the success of Delhi Metro, other cities in India also started exploring the options to implement metro projects. With this idea, more than 1 trillion INR was invested in metro projects in the year 1819. These projects are capital intensive and the challenge is to make it sustainable so that it's commercially viable, economically feasible, and creates a positive social impact. And to speak on the topic, we have the person who is spearheading the largest under construction metro rail project in the country. It's my privilege and honor to welcome our keynote for today. After all, she is a living inspiration for many. If one takes a closer look at the alchemy of achieving persons, two distinct virtues pop up, besides perseverance and hard work. These are pioneering spirit and willingness. Our keynote speaker belongs to the 1994 batch of the prestigious Indian Administrative Services. She has many firsts to her credit. Allocated to Maharashtra cadre, she is the first lady officer to hold prestigious portfolios like Joint MD CIDCO, Joint MD and MD MSRDC, and Transport Commissioner of Maharashtra. The final commissioning of the iconic Bandra Worli ceiling was done when she was MD MSRDC, when she also effectively structured projects like extension of the ceiling, water transport, expressways, flyovers, and intra-city road network. She enjoys the distinction of being selected on merit by IDFC to lead their public-private partnership vertical, where she spearheaded the India's infrastructure initiative, III, for 3 years. She has acquired a master's degree in major project management from SAIB Business School, University of Oxford, and PhD in infrastructure financing. Currently, she is serving as additional Metropolitan Commissioner, Mumbai Metropolitan Region Development Authority, MMRDA, where she is spearheading the ambitious Mumbai Metro Rail project of 14 lines, 337 kilometers. It's huge. Multimodal integration projects for last mile connectivity and integrated ticketing systems to make a world-class metro for Mumbai. Additionally, she is looking after infrastructure projects of roads, bridges, flyovers, etc., along with transport planning, urban planning, and development and other development works of the area covering 6,500 square kilometers with 9 municipal councils, 9 municipal corporations, 48 census towns, and 1427 villages in the Mumbai metropolitan region. So please join me in welcoming none other than Dr. Sonia Sethi with a huge round of applause. Welcome, ma'am. The forum is all yours.
Very good morning to all the delegates today. It is my proud privilege to deliver the keynote address to this very, very prestigious and important annual Metro Rail Summit. In keeping with the challenges of the times, this is a virtual summit, but nonetheless, I'm sure that all the delegates and all the people who will have access to the content of this discussion will all benefit from this interaction. I'm given to understand that this conference was originally scheduled on the 18th of March, but due to the pandemic, it was postponed, and today we are meeting on this virtual platform on the 27th day of October. So I think greetings to the organizers and everybody associated with this conference, this summit. All the organizers and the participants, who are making this day possible. And I am looking forward to the very, very interesting and informative discussions lined up during the day. Friends, the pandemic has been a kind of a crucible for all of us, a very transformative experience. Both in terms of our personal challenges and in terms of our professional goals. And you know, one of the things that you know I wake up to in the morning is, you know, being part of the iMetros group, where you know, in recent days I have started receiving you know, posts on the ridership figures of various metros throughout the country. And it is so heartening to see how team metros throughout the country have you know, resumed operations and are serving the nation you know, by resuming a very essential urban mobility service. So congratulations to all the MDs and their teams who have you know, resumed work. As far as you know, my own profile and portfolio is concerned, I'm primarily concerned now in the construction stage of the Mahamumbai Metro. And I think just as there have been challenges for resuming operations, for us in the construction space, the challenge has been to keep the vital infrastructure projects going despite various challenges on the ground level, especially, you know, shortage of labor. So having surmounted and I think continuously surmounting all these challenges, both sets of teams, the ones who are in operations and the ones who are in construction, I think we're all putting in our efforts to meet the challenges of these very extraordinary times. So I have seen that, you know, through interactions with my colleagues in various parts of the country and also through, you know, various platforms, like I mentioned, the iMetros, that both, you know, innovative and technical initiatives have been undertaken throughout the country to meet the challenge of COVID, whether it has been, you know, initiatives for contactless ticketing, or, you know, it's been following strict SOPs to resume operations. Even in the aspect of promoting indigenous products, basically the endeavor is a very sort of all-rounded, you know, multifarious effort to ensure that, you know, we are able to meet the challenges that are posed to us by the pandemic. So, as I said, that, you know, the challenges are different in operations and in construction, but I think we're all doing our best to meet these challenges. You know, I came across this quotation by this noted writer, John P. Potter, and I quote when he says, management is about coping with complexity, but leadership, by contrast, is about coping with change. And I think led by Mahua, all of us, you know, following the guidelines issued by the ministry and where applicable, the state government's initiatives, I think we're all, you know, doing our best to see that we provide leadership that is demanded of us in these very, very challenging times. So I congratulate all of you for your valor, for your bravery, and, you know, I think it would not be an exaggeration to say that all of us working in this sector are probably, you know, exposing ourselves to as much risk and also, you know, taking on the challenges that can be compared to all the rest of the frontline COVID warriors. So having said that, as I kind of touched upon a couple of, you know, concepts about changes that we are now dealing with, be it adaptive, be it technical. These are some of the changes that I will be speaking of in the context of the topic that is assigned to me today to address all of you, which is about making metro sustainable. And I think just the fact, you know, in the backdrop of the pandemic that I kind of touched upon, the fact that we have been able to continue working and the fact that we've been able to restart our services is also a testimony to the fact that, you know, we are committed to making, you know, the metro sustainable. So I think that by itself is a live testimony to, you know, the topic of my address today, which is about making metros sustainable. Now, as I speak, you know, after sort of talking to you about the bigger picture, we in Mumbai, as I said, of course, all of you are aware that Line 1 has been operational since 2014. But as far as MMRDA is concerned, we are totally and completely consumed with our immediate goal of providing 35 kilometers of metro services to the city by the month of May. So, you know, between now and the first trial that we have set for ourselves, you know, the date for which we have set for ourselves in January, and to the final commissioning of the two lines, which we name as Line 7 and Line 2A, in the month of May, I think we are currently, you know, dealing with all aspects of monitoring and implementation of, you know, completing our civil work and parallelly the systems integration process. So our reviews now are completely and totally focused on, you know, we've reached that stage of construction in these two lines where, you know, from viaduct and track access to, you know, OHE and SNT to actually planning for rolling stock trial to commissioning, you know, we have all these flow charts and, you know, we've sort of monitoring on a daily basis of achieving our target of, you know, actually commissioning two metro lines of MMRDA, as I said, 35 kilometers by the month of May. And the presentation that I have, you know, put together for you today is actually drawn from the real interventions and initiatives that we have taken especially for these first two lines that, you know, we are going to commission from MMRDA side. So my presentation, I would like to believe and I hope will touch a chord with all of you in being authentic, in being something that that actually speaks for itself in terms of talking about all aspects of making metro sustainable, which we have tried our best to incorporate. Not only the entire, you know, the metro implementation plan of Mumbai, but, you know, more so in the first two lines, which actually is always the biggest challenge, because actually implementing all these initiatives in the first two lines that we will be commissioning, you know, has been a huge, huge challenge. And but we are very hopeful that we will be able to meet the finishing line with all these value additions, which will add to, you know, creating a sustainable metro system for Mumbai. And so this is where I would like to draw your attention. I have a brief presentation and I, you know, request for your indulgence for a few minutes to just take you through the process of what we are actually doing in, you know, Mumbai Metro and how we are, you know, putting all these, you know, ideas from various sources, whether they were recommendations of the comprehensive transport study or various other consulting documents or best practices in the world, where we have tried to sort of absorb the best that, you know, we could incorporate in giving a world-class metro service to the financial capital of the country. And in the process, you know, sustainability has and always will be the key word for us. So I would now just request that we put the presentation and for your attention. As I mentioned, making metro sustainable is the mantra that we not only talk about, but we walk the talk by including it in all our interventions and applications for making this you know, this slogan a reality. Sustainability. We have divided into three broad categories in terms of environmental sustainability, in terms of technical stability and sustainability of the project, and also in terms of its financial viability. Okay, friends, so this is just a broad overview of the transport challenges in the Mumbai metropolitan region. Just to give the backdrop of you know, the problem that we are facing in this city. So overcrowded trains, air and noise pollution, traffic congestion, flooding, land acquisition challenges, road safety issues, and multiple planning and implementing agencies. So this is actually, you know, the kind of environment in which we have constructed and are continuing to construct our metro. So talking about, you know, metro as a means of urban transport, I you know, as I mentioned earlier, sustainability is something which, you know, by itself, Metro brings to the table, you know, by definition. I was actually going through the figures that, you know, public transport, unfortunately, has declined in the last two decades from 88% to 65% as a share of transport. And one of the major reasons in Mumbai for this is that, you know, the suburban train, you know, the 12-car suburban train in Mumbai has a super dense crush capacity of 2,400 persons. And in this scenario, you know, Metro by itself, you know, by providing an alternate in terms of mass transport, will bring, you know, the broader objective of, you know, moving people to mass transport and bringing sustainability. So, as I mentioned before, in 2014, you know, we constructed 11.4 kilometers of line one, which was actually, you know, as a result of the 2003 master plan. But I think the real momentum that the Mumbai Metro project has picked is in the last 5 years. And so 2015 onwards, I think there was no looking back. And the next slide, please. This is what we have now to share with you with some amount of legitimate pride and sense of achievement, that today MMRDA is implementing a master plan which comprises of a goal of 337 kilometers and 14 lines. And the kind of ridership that we expect this project to bring about is 12.75 million daily, and the cost of the project is 1.4 lakh crores. If you see the, you know, the alignments on the map on the screen, you will see that, you know, all lines are depicted in a different color, which is also a result of a branding exercise that we have done for our project. And so the first two lines that we will be commissioning in May 21 is line 7, which is the red line you can see on the screen, and line 2A, which is the yellow line that you see on the screen. Next, please. So this is actually, you know, my favorite slide, which I like to show in presentations, which actually captures the whole, you know, journey of construction of metros in Mumbai. So as I said, that in 2014, on PPP, 11.4 kilometers of Metro Line 1 was constructed. And most of the projects that we're implementing today actually kick-started in 2015 onwards. And 2A and 7, which you can see here, you know, the ones in orange are the ones which are under construction right now. So 2A, 7, and then you come to 2B, 4, 4A, 6, 3, and then 5 and 9. So in all, if you say 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 lines are currently parallelly, simultaneously under construction in Mumbai. And 3 lines are in the tendering stage, and the brown lines, 3 lines are in DPR stage. So it's actually perhaps, you know, maybe one of the largest, you know, mega project in scale and size that is currently in operation. And the other line that is crisscrossing is actually going to show how we are going to tackle the problem of traffic congestion. Next, please. Now, coming back to the specific or the specificities of the presentation about making Metro sustainable. Obviously, when we use the word sustainable, the first thing that comes to mind is environmental sustainability. How are we ensuring it through our Metro project? Next one, please. So this slide is kind of generic, which applies, you know, I think across the board when it comes to Metro, that reduction in CO2 emissions in particulate matters, in lower consumption of energy, and reduction of vehicular traffic on roads. So these are the inbuilt advantages of the Metro project, which certainly by default we are doing in Mumbai too. The next one. What we are also trying to go beyond our call of duty is to see how much we can do more in terms of showing our commitment to making a green Metro. So, you know, the specific interventions, some of them we have highlighted in this slide, about developing green metro stations, about optimizing air conditioning, harvesting natural lights, the regeneration of braking system, nurturing energy efficient technologies, use of state-of-the-art BVVF technology, and abiding by the IGBC council guidelines. So I think these are some of the specific interventions that that the Mumbai Metro project has incorporated in order to prove and manifest its commitment to making a green metro. Next, please. Now, on the technical front also, we are leaving no stone unturned to see that the assets survive for at least 120 years for which the life for which they are built, and that we provide a very durable, sustainable infrastructure project to the city. So let's go to the next one. In the last year and a half, we have been working a lot on improving and upgrading our station design and architecture, which we have made specific interventions and incorporated changes to make the stations more sustainable. We have made technical enhancements in our rolling stock specifications. We have today under construction a state-of-the-art operation and control center called Metro Bhavan, which is planned to control all 14 metro lines of Mumbai. We have a very, very comprehensive multimodal integration project in place. We have the ITS, or the integrated ticketing system, that is already in the process of implementation. Along with that, in keeping with the times, the common mobility application is designed and is in process to provide the best level of consumer care and comfort and ease in travel. And I would also be briefly touching upon STAND. Next, please. Now, you see, this is actually a picture of one of the model stations which we have designed, on the basis of which all the other 30 stations of Line 7 and 2A are currently being constructed and upgraded. As you can see from these pictures, the entry exit staircase is covered. There's natural ventilation by using louvers, and there's use of false ceiling. There is color branding. We're using stainless steel. We're studying stainless steel for visually impaired commuters, and the buildings are energy efficient. So the whole aim is that we have tried to give a world class infrastructure experience to Mumbaikars. I would also like to share here that we did not exceed the cost that was administratively approved for the project. In fact, we have done most of these interventions from the savings that we could make in the construction work. So there have been really no sort of cost overruns, but we have managed to use our money well in order to give a very sustainable and upgraded a station infrastructure to the city. Next, please. Now, this is the prototype of the train that Honorable Prime Minister had inaugurated, and the real sort of the first train we are expecting to be delivered by BEML in December. But this is the prototype, which gives a good idea about the look and feel of the coaches. Now we are proud to share that it's in keeping with the Make in India policy, and they are being totally manufactured at BEML. They are designed for driverless trains. There's use, as I mentioned before, of energy efficient BVVF technology is being used for propulsion system. There's a regeneration braking system. There's high level safety and automation, including surveillance systems, automatic door closing, dedicated place for wheelchair, cycle stand, SOS button in metro coaches. So again, you know, efforts to make the metro coaches safe, comfortable, and world class. This is the architectural design of the Metro Bhavan that I mentioned, which is going to be the mother OCC for all the trains, all the metro lines. And this is it hosts not just the OCC, but also a training center, residential office, and other facilities where we actually are targeting that our key staff will also be staying on site to monitor 27 the operations of this very ambitious project. Now we at Mumbai Metro are very proud to share that multimodal integration is something we take very seriously, and is something which we are not doing just as a pilot in an odd place, but something which is a composite part of our metro project. So multimodal integration is not new to the audience of this summit. We all understand the relevance and significance of improving first and last mile connectivity, promoting e-vehicles to provide more safety for road users, and the role of MMI in increasing metro ridership and in, of course, the rejuvenation of streets. So this is a typical rendition of how our multimodal project is going to transform the 250 meters radius around the stations which we have taken up in phase one. This would include wider footpaths, street furniture, bus bay, CCTV surveillance, landscaping, bollards, ramp for property entrance, signages, street light, and cycle track. Just if you go back to that. So I would like to share with the audience of this summit that, as I mentioned, that line 7 and 2A, which we will be commissioning in May, consists of 30 stations. And we have completed the task of tendering the contracts for the, in fact, we have awarded the contracts. And as I speak, we have just issued the work orders to the contractors to start this the actual physical construction of all these interventions which form a part of the multimodal integration contract. And with very strict timelines of 8 months, we are holding all the contractors of all the packages of these 30 stations to complete this work before monsoon. So it is our vision, it is our plan and hope that this particular project will be completed in time for the commissioning of the two lines. And that, I think, would be a huge, huge feather in the cap of Team MMRDA to manifest and to show that the entire last mile connectivity issues, which become a very, very important element in ensuring the sustainability of metro. And in fact, there have been enough studies to show that where last mile connectivity had not been given due thought, it was a deterrent in making the metro viable. So this is something which we have factored in at the construction stage to ensure that we are ready with the last mile connectivity interventions before commissioning of our two metro lines. Next, please. Along with that, the integrated ticketing system for MMR is something that, again, as I speak, the tender process is underway. We have already received the bids for the banking partner. And we are happy to share that we have been able to devise a system which is the open loop system. It's going to be interoperable and it's going to be completely compliant to NPCI and NCMC standards. So I think what I'm kind of trying to communicate through this slide is that while in multimodal integration, I talked about creating physical infrastructure for last mile connectivity through the integrated ticketing system, we are again providing the facility for commuters to have an efficient mode of ticketing. And what we are also trying to ensure through this card, and some of the features are all presented to you on the slide, that the value is carried on the transit fare card. The balance is determined as the rider travels. Fare readers to calculate the fare. The RuPay card can be used for travel, tolls, packaging fee, retail transaction, etc. It's within the current banking system, can be used in apps like MMRDA mobile app, which is something I'm going to show you in the next slide. And, it has features like, facilitates seamless transfer between modes, reduces time to purchase tickets, reduce fraud and revenue leakage, reduce administrative and fare collection cost, accurate and reliable information to people, development of fare policies and products based on data. And I'm happy to share that, we have received bids from the leading banks of the country, and it's very heartening for us to see that that the product that we devised got, a lot of attention from the banking sector and interest. And we are hopeful that whichever bank wins this contract will be able to, run this system very efficiently. Next, please. So along with the card, we have also gone in for the common mobility application. So basically, what we are saying here is that through the app, which is something which, increasingly, and more so, I think, in the urban areas, people are now familiar with apps. So interventions are not just limited to the card, but also to creation of an app. And we are just on the eve of receiving bids for the mobile app technology partner. And some of the features of this common mobility application are data ownership, application platform, dashboard, recharge facility, multiple PTO aggregation platforms. So basically, we see this as a composite intervention of the card and the mobile app. So which is our effort to give efficient ticketing facilities to our customers, and also to provide the most efficient last mile connectivity. Next. So I had also mentioned STAMP to you, that is the Station Access and Mobility Program. And this is something that we at MMRDA are happy to be involved with. And the objective is better crowd management and connectivity to metro. We launched it last year, and through this initiative, we seek solutions for building efficiencies in managing passenger flow and passenger dispersion at stations. And one of the interventions, under this, which we are very happy to share, is the Yulu Bike scheme of last mile connectivity, which has already started in MMRDA, and it's doing well. So that's something which we are very happy to share. Now, last but not the least, I think, is the question of making metros financially viable. And this is the third arm of the sustainability presentation that I have in front of you today. Next, please. So I would like to share that even before our first two lines are commissioned, we have already, incorporated MMM OCL, or we call it the M-Cube. So this is actually, incorporated to take care of the future operation and maintenance of all the metro lines. And we have already done the top level recruitments and of the MD and the directors of the key verticals like operations. And so what I'm basically trying to say is we already have the structure in place, the organizational structure that is going to run the metros as they get commissioned. And from today, even as I said, that before the commissioning actually happens, MCube is already in the process of hiring the personnel, and training programs have been designed already. In fact, training programs have started, and we will be in complete readiness as far as the operations and maintenance of the lines are concerned. Some of the steps for ensuring the financial viability of the metros are now in the brainstorming stage. While we are devising a bigger plan for cash flows other than the fair revenue, some steps that have already been initiated are the asset management system and ERP system, predictive maintenance, last mile connectivity, reduction in manpower cost, TOD and use of solar energy. These are actually A to F actually list out some of the interventions that are already either planned or in various stages of finalization. So our teams are already working on these to be in readiness before the commissioning happens. And as I speak with you here, we are in the process of appointing a consultant who will also help to devise the non-fare box strategy for us. Now we do understand, and we have gone through a very interesting concept paper prepared by DMRC on this subject, and it was actually circulated to all the metros for their views. And it does talk about property development, property business, consultancy, various forms of value capture financing. So these are things that all metros are in their own way grappling with or trying to find models that best suit their ecosystem or their cities. And and certainly we will benefit from papers like this and expert advice on how best to make our metros financially viable, so that we can do our operation and maintenance as per the best practices in the world. So as I said, that we still have some time before commissioning, but as I said, May end is our target. So in the next 6-8 months, we hope to have this whole the financial model and also the whole strategy for non-fare box revenue in place. And so can we just go to the next one? So basically what I'm saying is that since that there would be delegates, and I'm going through the list of participants, a lot of whom are already in operation and maintenance stage, be in Mumbai, are in the stage of actually constructing and planning for operations. So I would like to believe that I have been able to communicate a sense of readiness to all of you here, that our teams are working simultaneously to ensure that not only are all the interventions required for sustainability of metros, be it technical, be it environmental, are already incorporated in the design and implementation, and also that parallelly work has already begun in terms of setting up the organizational structure, and they are already working on models to make our entire metro network financially viable. So this is briefly what I wanted to share with you in terms of saying that how do we make metro sustainable. As I said in the beginning, metro as a mode of communication by itself spells sustainability. So I think having said that, each one of us who is directly involved in the construction and the operation, or who are stakeholders in this project, have a duty and a sense of obligation to ensure that we do whatever it takes to make the metros sustainable, for the commuters. And I started my my discussion with you in the light of the remarks on the pandemic, and there are varied views about how people have coped in the last 6-8 months without travel, and while various e-platforms emerged to sort of help people cope with the situation. I came across this very interesting article, and I'm sure some of you would have also had a chance to read it by this authority on mobility, John Puri, and he talks about mobility and proximity. And in that he says that the quote that I have in front of you basically sums up the fact that metro as a means of urban mobility, it's so I think relevant for us to understand the relevance of the work that we are doing, that by providing urban mobility in the form of mass transport, not only are we providing not only are we moving the wheels of the economy, but it is so crucial to build what John Dewey calls social capital, the networks that keep a society's wheels moving efficiently and effectively. So I think there is no substitute to travel, and travel not only for, as I said, to move the wheels of economy, but also to build social capital, which is a very fundamental human need. And I think all of us who are working in this sector are blessed to have this opportunity to work towards creating this infrastructure, to create this service. And I'm sure that with this kind of a quotation that I sort of leave with you, there would be a kind of a renewed sense of validation about the work we are doing, as I said, which has not just economic but also social implications. So I wish all of you who are participants in today's summit good luck and lots of good wishes. And I started by saying that all of you are heroes who are working in these very challenging times. Keep up the morale and continue to do good work. I thank the organizers, for arranging this summit, even though on a virtual platform, because I'm very hopeful and confident that it would boost the morale of the participants. It would lead to good exchange of ideas, and as they say, the show must go on, and we need to work with renewed energy and renewed vigor to attain and provide this vital infrastructure to all the cities that we are working in. So once again, I thank the organizers and I thank you all for this address. And I look forward to your good wishes to us also at Team Mumbai, who are, as I shared with you, working on the countdown for the commissioning of two of our lines. So I seek your blessings and good wishes, and I convey notes and words of good wishes to all of you. And I wish this conference, this summit, huge success. Thank you.
I'm sure the audience really got to learn a lot, as I did. After seeing this, Mumbai is soon going to have a world-class integrated transport system. There is a lot of inquisitiveness amongst the audience, and we are getting many questions. But since there is a paucity of time, you may always answer them offline through the chat box. Thank you so much, ma'am, for sparing time and being here today despite your such a tight schedule. Thank you so much.
Thank you.